Ramesh Raskar joined the Media Lab, MIT Media Lab, from Mitsubishi Electric Research Laboratories in 2008 as the head of Lab's Camera Culture Research Group. His research interests span the fields of computational light transport, computational photography, inverse problems in imaging, and human-computer interaction in general. Recent projects and inventions include transient imaging to look around the corner, a next-generation CAT scan machine, imperceptible markets for motion capture, long-distance barcodes, touch hover 3D interaction displays, and many more. And one of the inventions that we've seen was Netra, and right now it's already an active company, is selling the inexpensive tools to check your vision. He's a recipient of TR100 Award from Technology Review, Global Technovator Award, and maybe 20 other important awards. So thank you for approaching the topic of future of global health, and I can't wait to hear your talk.
Thank you, Renata, and thank you for the invitation. Let me talk about health diagnostics. And when we think about health diagnostic devices, we often think of such over-engineered instrumentation. Here, for cataract, a slit lamp device that really hasn't changed for several decades. Or to get a retinal scan. And this is a $250,000 device, but check out the user interface. You know, the nurse has to shove my head into the eyepiece so that my eye is aligned for the retinal picture. And to get prescription for eyeglasses, I'm lost in this four-opter. And this is all fine in developed countries, but in global health, in developing countries, millions are suffering from conditions that otherwise have really simple solutions. So we came up with a solution called Netra, which is a near-eye tool for refractive assessment, where we can use a snap-on eyepiece on top of a cell phone. You will look through it, see some patterns, click to align those patterns, and when they're aligned, you hit calculate, and it gives you data for prescription of your eyeglasses. And that additional eyepiece costs only a few dollars, and the data you would get is comparable to some of the high-end autorefractors. And if you look at this simple problem of providing eyeglasses, there are more than 500 million people worldwide who need glasses but don't wear them. And that's mainly because not the cost of the eyeglasses, but the cost of the diagnostics is extremely high. So given these two pieces of the puzzle of diagnostics and dispensing glasses, fortunately over time, the cost of providing eyeglasses has come down to about $3. You can sell them on the street for $3 and everybody still makes money. But on the diagnostic side, we still don't have a good solution. So if you start looking at some of the highest end solutions for getting a refractive error in your eye, they involve using something called a wavefront sensor, where you shine a laser at the back of your eye and take its picture. And as you can imagine, these devices are very complicated, very expensive, and have to be regulated because you're shining light into your eye. So let me give you a flavor on the kind of approaches we take in my group here at MIT Media Lab and try to get around these pesky problems of over-engineered instruments. So as I said, my group here at MIT Media Lab is called Camera Culture. And we do a lot of work in various kinds of imaging, various types of cameras. I'll briefly talk about this femtosecond imaging, how we can look at the world at 1 trillion frames per second and various types of 3D displays that can be glasses free. And with new types of imaging, we can start asking questions that seemingly challenge our notion of what it means to use a camera. For example, can we build a camera that can look around corners beyond line of sight? And the idea is to use the flash, which will bounce light off of visible surfaces, like a door in this case. Part of the light will go into the room, a fraction of the light will come back to the door, an even tinier fraction back to the camera. And if you can do analysis of multiple bounces of light, it turns out you can actually look around corners. So this is not science fiction. We have already shown it in a laboratory setup. Here's our ultra-fast camera, the hidden mannequin, and we're going to bounce light from this door to look around corners. So after our paper was published, Nature.com highlighted it, and they created this very nice animation. So I'm just showing the animation that was created by them. So you shine light on this visible surface, a packet of photons. Those packet of photons scatter, go into the hidden part. The hidden objects, in turn, start scattering this light again. Some of them reach the visible surface, and as I said, a tinier fraction of them will reach back at the camera. But the interesting part is when they reach the camera, all of them will have a slightly different time slot. They will arrive at a slightly different time. And by exploiting this time dimension, we can do some amazing things. So for that, we use a scientific instrument called streak tube, and we change its optics and illumination and so on, where we have a space resolution of less than a millimeter. And the simple fact that different parts in the hidden scene are going to be reflected with different time slot allows us to do this reconstruction beyond line of sight. And then, very much like tomography, X-ray tomography, by shining point on different parts of the scene, we can start recording individual images that make no sense at all because it's scattered information. It's not like LiDAR, where you can see what's in the line of sight and exploit the time of flight to get distance. This is not LiDAR. We are looking at scattered light, which doesn't make any sense in individual pictures, but we can piece together many of these individual photos and reconstruct the hidden object in three dimensions. So right now, in a 30 by 30 centimeter working volume, our precision is about half a centimeter, about 5 millimeters. And we hope we can improve that with new technology. And it's going to take us a long time to take this out of the lab and take it out. But if you can, then in the future, you can imagine building cars that can avoid collision of what's around the bend, or look for survivors in hazardous conditions by pinging light through visible surfaces like windows and doors. And for this audience, also start building endoscopes that can reach deep inside the body without beyond occluders. As you know, endoscopes that used to have the sensor outside and a fiber bundle inside the endoscope, now we have next generation of endoscopes where the image sensors are right next to the surface that you want to image. But there's an inherent signal-to-noise ratio. There's only so small you can make these endoscopes in terms of imaging. And we are already down to about a micrometer in the resolution of individual pixels. So it's challenging to make something that's even smaller than that, smaller than the wavelength of light. So we may have to jump into another revolution to think about how we might be able to do endoscopy well beyond the traditional narrow paths. And another interesting part is that you can start using such endoscopes in situations where you may have other scatterers like tissue and blood. And we haven't solved this problem, so it's still a concept sketch, but in our group we are spending a lot of time thinking about how we can build such instrumentation that can see deep inside our body. The data that comes from this ultra-fast devices, as I said, just looks like a bunch of streaks, bunch of lines and curves. But for the longest time, we have been looking at data like this. But one day I woke up and said, you know what? We can actually take this data and try to visualize that in some really unique ways. So about 50 years ago, you may have seen this picture from Doc Edgerton of a bullet through an apple right here at MIT. And Doc Edgerton was a scientist himself trying to image scientific phenomena. But I guess at some point he realized that you can just look at an ordinary world at extremely high speed. And earlier we heard about Michelangelo and his desire to look at flapping of the wings of birds. So every time we have a new instrument that can look at the world in unique ways, it impacts many fields, especially medicine and health. So this particular picture has exposure time of less than 1 millionth of a second, less than 1 microsecond. But it was created not by a fancy camera, but a fancy light source, an illumination source that had extremely short duration. But now 50 years later, we can go a million times faster and start looking at the world at 1 trillion frames per second, where the exposure time is less than 1 trillionth of a second. And I call this femtophotography. It's kind of a new type of imaging. It's so fast that we can see light in motion. We can see photons in motion. So just in the interest of time, I'll jump ahead and show you this movie of how we can see light in slow motion. So I'm going to send a laser beam into this bottle, and you're going to see how light propagates through the scene. It's like throwing a stone in a pond of water. So there's a lot going on in this movie, so let me try to break this down. So we're going to send a femtosecond laser pulse into this bottle, which is like a bullet of light. It scatters through this milky water. You start getting energy fronts propagating through this bottle. Meanwhile, the light leaks here, and you see energy fronts propagating here. The majority of photons get hidden behind this Coca-Cola label. They appear on the other side. There's a pocket of air here, so you'll see light bouncing around inside here. Many of the photons go and hit the cap and the leak on the table, and you'll again see energy fronts going away. So you already see energy going here. Light has leaked down over here. Photons going through, they reappear. Hit the cap. Meanwhile, light is bouncing around, as you can see. Light leaks through, goes out here. Light is bouncing around. Because of the curvature, you also get a focusing effect, and some photons appear here after several picoseconds. And the whole event took place effectively in less than 1 nanosecond, one billionth of a second, because that's how long roughly it takes for light to travel. So these are new tools, and we can start looking at the world in very unique ways. And here's a time lapse that we created, but the time lapse where the total duration is about 1 nanosecond. And clearly, these devices cannot be used in a single shot mode because, as you know, as photographers, if you take a very short exposure photo, you're not going to get any photons at all. You're not going to get much light. So what we do is we take this photo millions of times, about 7.5 million times, to create this one short movie. But that event is, again, taking up in 1 nanosecond. We're just going to sample the same event about 7 or 8 million times. So we can take many of these concepts and start applying in new regimes, as I said. And some other projects that we are thinking about in global health are cell phone microscopy, where exploiting the fact that the pixel pitch of your cell phones on the display side is down to 25 micrometers, and on the sensor side is down to about 1.4 micrometers. So that's approaching the resolution of some of the highest end microscopes that you have. And by exploiting multiple cell phones, it turns out we can repurpose these cell phones for unique types of imaging. We build human-computer interaction devices and also think about how we can use millions of photos that people are taking and uploading in space. So one of the projects we are focusing on is a new type of a CAT scan machine. And as you know, in a CAT scan machine, you have an X-ray source and X-ray detectors, and they're spinning at a very high speed. But if you open up a CAT scan machine and take a look, okay.
And now just imagine is your head is inside the jet engine. So these devices, when they go from generation 1 to 2 to 3 to 4, I think we can stop here.
When they go from one generation to the next, what they're really improving is the speed at which this monster can spin, or the number of detectors this monster has. I mean, as you know, CAT scan machine could only be installed in the basement of hospitals and clinics. And only in the last few years, you can start putting them in a first or second floor, and they still create about 15 G of acceleration. You know, they have to use kind of space age, aircraft grade material to support that. And this is totally ridiculous. It doesn't make any sense to build CAT scan machine using the same old principles. So what we're doing in our group is we have built a new design, and we have already verified it using optical schemes and working with our collaborators in nuclear engineering to build new CAT scan machines that in the future could be as flexible as headbands and wristbands and chest bands, have completely flexible architecture and have no mechanically moving parts. Because 90% of the complexity in a CAT scan machine is because of the speed and the need for mechanical motion. So we're able to get around that with this new technology. We don't have a solution today, but it'll take us a few years to get to that stage. And coming back to our device to get refraction using small attachments, again, it's the same thing. We can either use lasers and continue to make the technology better and better and cheaper using the same elements, or use a completely new mechanism like a cell phone, realizing that the pixel pitch of a cell phone now is, as I said, down to 25 micrometers, you can attach a very simple eyepiece that costs next to nothing and start building a so-called Shark-Hartmann wavefront sensor, where we can shine light into your eye with very, very fine precision. But instead of a laser, we're just asking you to hold the centerfold right next to your eye. I mean, nothing can be more safe than that. And the basic technique around that is in a typical Shark-Hartmann wavefront sensor, you have to record the light that's coming out of your eye. But here we are asking you to manipulate images on the screen and perform basically an alignment task. So, and when the lines are aligned, the number of clicks it takes you to align the lines gives us the data for prescription of your eyeglasses. If your power is 5, you may have to click 5 times to bring the lines into alignment. And if your power is -3, you'll have to click the other way 3 times to bring the lines into alignment. And there is something amazing happening with mobile phones. I don't have to really tell you that, because if you look at the wars that are going on, you know, the numbers in billions of dollars get thrown out, get discussed all the time. So, you know, the retina display, we are really using it to look at your eye. Because the retina display has 326 dots per inch. If you divide the numbers, it's about 26 micrometers for each individual pixel. So we can take these devices, and smartphones are proliferating everywhere, and really think of your cell phone and an attachment to it as a thermometer for your eye, because just like many problems in global health, it's not about the health issue itself, it's the manifestation of it. So to give children a decent shot at education, all they need to provide them is $3 of eyeglasses, but about 1 in 10 in developing countries don't go to school because they are considered very dumb to understand what's going on in school when all they need is a pair of eyeglasses. Or for a laborer or a farmer to be able to perform their daily tasks is challenging. So unemployment and poverty is a huge problem. And again, roughly 10% of the population in developing countries is pushed to poverty just because of poor vision. And sometimes, I know Renata is going to Brazil tomorrow, sometimes you just have to watch Ronaldinho, you know, kick that soccer goal and you want to watch that on TV. So, you know, that's an important part of your life as well. So when this project started in our group about 3 years ago, We're very excited, and we got very good response from various partners in global health. But in the end, it all came to a blank because we couldn't figure out how to really make this happen. And so we really had to go back to the drawing board because the NGOs we were working with could not change their workflow and they could not absorb the technology. The clinics that we were working with could not work with technology that was not completely proven at a large scale. And we realized that this is something we have to do on our own. And so a lot of the great ideas I'm hearing about here, I'm sure you're facing similar issues. You know, there's a big chasm between the technology and its adaptation. So in our case, you know, we went to the drawing board. This is my colleague, David Shafran. You know, spent a lot of time on ground, work with our collaborators such as Alvi Prasad Eye Institute in India, talk to eyeglasses, optical stores, people on the street, and really started looking at what it means to provide solutions for eye care in different parts of the world. And the answers we got were amazing. The awareness was a huge issue. Many people didn't even know that a simple pair of eyeglasses could change the way they look at the world. And on the other hand, the people who do want to sell eyeglasses are very excited to sell them, and they have distribution pipelines, but they don't know where people are and how to convince them that they should be wearing eyeglasses. So after a lot of these discussions, we came to this realization that we need to really try to solve the end-to-end problems and not solve it ourselves, but empower others to solve different pieces of this puzzle. And the eventual solution was to decouple the diagnostics from delivery and create an electronic ecosystem, which could be as simple as some kind of EMR or EHR. And it turns out that decoupling alone dramatically changes the way we can make this happen. So as Renata said, we spun out a venture called iNetra.com, and if you go to the website, you will see a lot of the details on how this is being done. And coming back to mobile phones, we all know about App Store, and we download software, we play with it, but I think we're entering a new era of a hardware App Store, not just software App Store, where you might get a very low-cost attachment to your mobile phone that will allow you to transform your phone into a new type of a scientific instrument or a diagnostic instrument. You know, after we talked to our collaborators on refraction, they said, but the leading cause of blindness is actually cataract. The second leading cause of avoidable blindness is refraction. So for cataract, we said, well, let's think about another hardware attachment to a mobile phone. So we went back to our drawing boards, started ripping open LCDs and other devices, and this is the kind of things we do in our lab, and eventually came with a solution that, again, looks very much like Netra, which is a snap-on eyepiece, and would give you a very quick answer on a very quick answer to whether you have cataract, and within that, what's the map of your cataract. So I have the instrument with me, and maybe we'll do the tests during the break. And we're really focusing on the eye because we think it's a mirror of health, and many systemic conditions, as you know, have very clear manifestation, ocular manifestation. I believe we are talking about diabetic retinopathy and OCT from our colleagues at Blue Highway. So within that, we said, also, what about retina? Because that seems like a very challenging problem. But again, you can build solutions that look as simple as eyeglasses. Put on the eyeglasses with all the instrumentation in it, perform really simple tasks that are user-driven, and at the end of the day, you can create relatively high-resolution images of your retina in a multispectral manner. So let me show you this quick video of where we are. So again, the device look as simple as eyeglasses, and the doctor can start looking at the retina in real time. In this case, you're just getting very simple feedback to the patient of where it should be. And in real time, you can start seeing resolution of about 100 to 150 micrometers on the screen. And we can use a lot of computational techniques to take this to the next level. Remember, at 1.4 micrometer of resolution on a camera in a cell phone, you can really start doing interesting things. And Karen Roche from our group is also here, so I'm sure she can talk to you during the break. So one of my passion is to really start thinking about the mobile phone. It has unbelievable amount of input and output technologies. On the input, you have microphones and gyroscopes and GPS and pressure sensor, and it has just unbelievable stuff going in, and you'll see more and more getting in there. And same with the output as well. And you know, billions of people out there are walking around with a scientific instrument in their pocket. And we have to figure out how we can repurpose that for what we want to do. And another dimension of this may be interesting for discussion over cocktails in the evening is that, you know, in the beginning, we in the health medical industry, we tried to build really great experts, but they didn't have great tools. And then over time, we said, let's build better devices. But if you go to a clinic today, the more underutilized resource is the patient himself or herself. And we hope that, you know, this event that Renata has organized on thinking about the future of health is looking at not just the first two pieces of the puzzle, but also this final piece. And your thoughts on how we might be able to use social media and crowdsourcing and gamification are going to play a very important role here as well. Thank you.